Everybody all right?
Yes, sir.
All power to the people.
All power to the people.
All power to the people.
All power to the
people. Today is the 49th anniversary of the founding of your Black Panther Party. Y'all dead. I can't say that today is the 49th anniversary of the founding of your Black Panther Party. You know, I remember when I turned 49, I still felt somewhat good. Right? So you got to clap for yourself if don't nobody else clap. Just by way of introduction, a lot of things are in the air that need to be addressed. And we thought it was important to address some of these things from an affirmative space. A positive space, a space of conviction and clarity to help move things along. We're going to dedicate the night, and we'll hear from him before the evening is over, to our beloved Daruba Bin Wahad, the field secretary of the Black Panther Party and a combatant in the Black Liberation Army. And a former political prisoner who served 19 years in the New York State Prison, and is one of the few of his comrades that was blessed to have gotten out through legal means. Today, as we gather, no matter the circumstance, we still have dozens of Daruba's comrades who are still in prison, and a majority of them are in or connected to New York State. So much for being liberal in New York, in America, in post-racial age of Obama, 2015, 16, or wherever the hell we at. All right? Also comes in the background of Daruba and directly in the party, indirectly coming under some odd and not so odd forms of attack. On August 8th, 2014, in front of his own home, Daruba was physically accosted by a Clayton County police officer, and by the grace of the God of our ancestors, we were able to get that on videotape. And as we speak, that drama of and senseless case of police brutality is making its way through the Georgia court system. Just recently, and even uglier, and I have to say this too, I'm as much a cub of Lombe Brath as I am of the Daruba Bin Wahad, took place with the police. That just happened to be on May 2nd. May 2nd, of course, May 2nd is the anniversary of the Turnpike Massacre, where Asada and Sundiata and Zaid were attacked by New Jersey State Troopers. And y'all know the rest of that history. It's just interesting that that took place on May 2nd. August 8th this year, which happens to be the birthday of Dr. Motulu Shakur, another one of Daruba's comrades, at an Atlanta gathering of what's left of one of four factions of the New Black Panther Party, this particular faction led by one Malik Zulu Shabazz, out of some strange energy in place, these fools decided to put their hands on our elder and our brother. And so delusional was the person who gave this order, and this is according to their version of the facts, said very simply, and pardon me for using expressive language, get his ass out of here. Very clear. It wasn't the chairman of the New Black Panther Party that said it. It wasn't the national spokeswoman of the New Black Panther Party who said it. It wasn't the national chief of staff who said it. It was Malik Zulu Shabazz who said it. And upon that order, about a dozen or so men in New Black Panther Party uniforms proceeded to beat one of the persons who they should be trying to protect and on whose shoulders they should stand. And so our modest call for this particular thing is not just to condemn that, but if those men under Mr. Shabazz's command had some semblance of just a little political education, a little history, they would not have even thought of doing anything like that. And of course, Mr. Shabazz would not have been able to enforce such a reckless order with total disrespect for the legacy that he claims to be trying to uphold as he did. So there has since been a condemnation that's gone all around the country, all around the world, from Mumia on down. And with that condemnation, thankfully, comes isolation. People need to be held accountable and calling themselves leaders when they do foolish things. Now, if you're supposed to be fighting for the people and you turn on the people, yeah, you need to be held accountable in a range of ways that have all kinds of possibilities, you know? And it was a very, very disheartening, very ugly kind of thing. So in spite of that, we're here just to let people who, some young folks who may not know who this man is, let them know. Let them come to appreciate on their own, make up their own mind as to who this man is and what this legacy represents, right? So that's the gist of why we're here. Just a couple other things by way of introduction. Principal organizers for this are, of course, Mr. T.J. Whitaker and myself. We are both Daruba's cubs from the Campaign to Free Black and New African Political Prisoners. We worked with Daruba when he got out. In fact, I was there when he got out on March 22nd, 1990. It's a mind-blowing kind of day. And we've had our own bonds with him and his comrades as a consequence of that that we're very proud of. We just, for sake of identification purposes, and it's something we're looking to develop, we call what we're doing the New Jersey Black Panther Party Commemoration Committee, with the hopes that we can do several things. One, identify and bring into the fold any young persons who are interested in working with a Panther support-like structure like this in any one of a number of ways that they would like to work with it. We have some young people here, for instance, that are documenting this event for us from the Student Entertainment Organization. I want you to give them a strong hand and acknowledge them, please. What we hope we can do with that is put together some more forums like this and some oral history interviews where we actually, you know, get to our elders and sit them down and let them really get this history out. And it's important, not just because of what they did, but because, listen, we need to face the fact also that ain't none of us going to be here forever. When Daruba was attacked, he was 71 years young. I know he don't look it. He keeps himself together. One of the reasons why he survived that. You know, I hope I make 71. All right. Okay? But he keeps himself together. But, you know, a lot of his comrades are not here. And in a minute, I'm going to do a libation of some of his comrades just to invoke the proper energy from our ancestors in the way that we do. So that's just a summary introduction of what we do over the next hour. We'll hear from TJ, we'll hear from Tyree Onaji, who's trying to lay in the cut in the back, who's with us in the Campaign to Free Black and New African Political Prisoners. We'll hear from Eitan Edwards, who's here. Good to see you, brothers. We don't see you much. We're really glad to see you. We'll hear from Bilal Abdul-Hakim. Bilal actually was still inside. He was on the back end of a prison bid that he did when Daruba was on the back end of his bid. They met in prison, and Bilal will later come help us in the campaign, Bilal from Patterson and the Power Coalition. We'll hear from a young poet and my goddaughter, Jalissa McKeachin, and we should get a call from Daruba himself. You'll get to hear from Daruba himself in spite of the difficulty of his medical circumstance. Over the course of the evening, I'll also give you something for four of his comrades who are in prison. Never would we do anything like this without acknowledging and doing something by way of support of acknowledging some of his comrades who are still inside. So we will do also a spotlight on four political prisoners who were in medical crisis. Imam Jamil Abdullah El-Amin, the former H-Rap Brown, who's facing life in the Pennsylvania prison. Robert Seth Hayes, name you may not know, a powerhouse in the Black Liberation Army and the Black Panther Party in the New York chapter with the Ruba. In fact, Mr. Hayes' birthday, and that's what the prison guards call him, Mr. Hayes, right? That's how he rolls. His birthday is today. The quietest is kept. Mr. Hayes is struggling with diabetes and hepatitis C almost as badly as Mumia is. And of course, Mumia's case and what he's facing with his health is an international story. And who else did I say? I said four. And of course, yes, Russell Maroon Schultz, who, credible BLA combatant, spent most of his time in solitary confinement, just recently was put into general population, only to be diagnosed with prostate cancer. So Mumia is not the only political prisoner in medical crisis. And prison is no place to be sick, especially when you got a jacket like our freedom fighters do. So we're going to give you something for them to acknowledge them as our day, as our evening rolls on. But let's just do very quickly a modest libation. I'm going to spotlight several of Daruba's comrades from the mighty New York chapter of the Black Panther Party. I'm going to spotlight also what we call, or what Alombe Brath taught us, and I'll acknowledge Alombe too because he's an ancestor now, what we call the Martyrs of October. Today is October 15th. Yes, sir. 1987, the man who led the Burkina Faso Revolution was assassinated on this day back in 1987. But let's start with that. When I say Ibaye, y'all know what to say, right? Two of y'all in here know what I'm talking about? Ibaye means give thanks. In the Yoruba language, one of the original languages of our ancestors and one of the important cultural survivals as our ancestors were brought here in captivity. And Ashe is the answer, which means yes, so be it. And it's the foreparent of what you call amen in church and what Muslims call Amin in the mosque. All right, y'all all right with that?
Sure.
All right. For the four directions, the north and the south, the east and the west, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
For the martyrs of October, October 9th, mark the anniversary of the execution of one of the most incredible revolutionary figures of the modern age, the immortal Ernesto Che Guevara, October 9th, 1967. For Che, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Maurice Bishop led the New Jewel Movement just off the coast of Florida in Grenada. Small island, only about on the size of Elizabeth of Jersey City, but became a national threat to the security of the United States. So Ronald Reagan and others decided to overthrow that and invade that island. For Maurice Bishop and the New Jewel Movement, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Greece, we lost him on October 19th, 1983. Then Samora Machel, Mozambique, both are also on October 19th in 1986. We say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
I mentioned Alombe. Of course, Alombe was one of our master teachers in the center of Harlem. He helped bring all of us together on so many fronts. An elder of our Miss Dearly, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Now for some of his New York comrades, Lumumba Shakur, Ibaye.
Ashe.
Zaid Shakur, all right on that turnpike, Ibaye.
Ashe.
Twyman Myers, who scared the hell out of the white man with the Black Liberation Army, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Safiu Bukari, fearless fighter, the Black Liberation Army in the party, Ibaye.
Ashe.
Bashir Hamid, who started the was a field secretary for the New Jersey chapters of the Black Panther Party, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
Teddy Jahithu went and jacked the white gangsters in order to show black gangsters how to protect their community. Died in captivity, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
The avenging angel, Alva Lou Washington, who died in captivity, we say Ibaye.
Ashe.
Ibaye.
Ashe.
One of their baddest recruiters who saw combat first in the jungles of the mountains of Korea, then the jungles of Vietnam, and then after the height of the Newark Rebellion, left the white man's army and joined the Black Panther Party. Mr. Mark A. Smith, we used to call him Smitty back in the day. We say Ibaye. Ibaye. You can't start a war nowhere without Geronimo. For Geronimo Jijaga Pratt, we say Ibaye. Ibaye. So for all the martyrs of October, and for all of the Ruba's comrades who are in the land of the ancestors, we say Ibaye. For the north, the south, the east, and the west, we say Ibaye. Y'all all right? Yourselves a strong hand. And we're going to start. Let's just start rocking. Hey, Todd, you came the furthest. I'm going to bring you up. Give us some few. Now, this brother, one of the things, let me bring you up this way, brother. One of the things that's important to appreciate about the legacy of the Black Panther Party. Now, most folks, especially those of us who were governed by testosterone, were, of course, intrigued by the fact that this was a group of young men who, locked and loaded, stood up to the police, stood up to the police state, stood up to the pig. Right? But there was so much more to the Black Panther Party. Black Panther Party had 62 community survival programs. They truly did serve the people. I'm a child of a sickle cell anemia family, and I remember how they made sickle cell anemia a national story in the late 1960s and the early 1970s. Black Panther Party, right? I'm a child of the war on poverty out of embarrassment. Embarrassment by these Panthers feeding these hungry black kids all in these ghettos. They started putting food in schools early in the morning, and then along came something called food stamps. Black Panther Party was the agent behind it, was the agent of change that made that happen. It wasn't no Lyndon B. Johnson liberalism. Black Panther Party. And this young man here we're about to bring up now is a specialist in community survival. So we're going to let him give you a few minutes of his impression of why we love and honor this man that we call Daruba today. Give him a strong black hand. Eitan Edwards.
Power to the people. Power to the people. Well, I see some folks coming in. Well, first of all, I want to thank you for coming today. And, it's great to see that this vibrancy and this strength is still here in the community, and we're going to need it now more than ever, as we've seen with recent events. What I want to say to you is that number one is that when we speak of community survival, and what I've been doing over the past, now it's almost 30 years, is a continuance of the work of the original Black Panther Party. And I stand here not only in remembrance and honor our brothers and sisters who fought to do this, I also stand here for Daruba bin Wahad, who even after this horrific episode has continually, I can tell you that in speaking to Brother Daruba, almost right after it happened, that Brother Daruba was thinking about how we must get our community prepared and how we are going to help our community to survive. So if anything, I want you all to just in thought or just even in spirit to again to show some energy for our brother who continues to fight, to show you the level of dedication that Brother Daruba has and all of us that are in this, but specifically for Daruba because he's gone through a terrible ordeal. And, it's about the work. And that's why I'm here today, and I'm going to make what I have to say short and sweet, but we need to speak about this as Daruba would want me to. On my way here today, I was talking about how much work we have to do as a people. And because I'm aware of a lot of the different global situations, local situations, and what have you, but also the incredible hostile situations that we have here in the United States. And the threat of disasters looms over us in many different ways. We're just coming off of the 10th year anniversary of Katrina. And unfortunately, that's one of the disasters we experienced. We're going to experience more. And one of the most important aspects of the new, the original Black Panther Party's 10-point program was survival. Some of y'all aren't old enough to remember it, but it was Juche. It was about the Korean principle Juche, but that's the word, means self-reliance. And we as a community must become self-reliant now. We've been talking about this, but it's about being about it right now, as we can see that the hostile elements within this nation are starting to close in. And one of the things that Daruba fears and one of the things that I fear is that we're going to experience another catastrophe. And our community is not going to be ready to deal with it. And in speaking to some of my comrades on the way to this venue today, I think that one of the things that I would want to have a takeaway for this gathering is that we have to start now. We have to start tonight. I would like it that everyone who signs this paper and to maintain contact with each other so that we can start a small cell that is a survival cell, as the enemy is doing the very same thing in mass. I was just talking about the organization. I won't even say the name of the organization, but you've probably heard a lot about it. Who they were actually in St. Louis on the ground, armed and supposedly working in collusion with some of the police and also supposedly helping some of the protesters. But I can tell you that this particular organization is ready, expanding, and building. And we are not doing these things, and we must do these things, because the elements of control are doing this themselves. They're doing this to compromise us in ways that I can't even begin to explain here. I was just talking about, with one of my comrades about when in uprisings, in the past they used to use tear gas, but in future uprisings, we're going to move into these areas, and all of a sudden you might see someone stop and scream in pain because the enemy is using directed energy weapons to contain dissent. The active denial system is a microwave weapon. We've gone into a new era of control, and we've got to recognize this as a people. And the only way that we're going to survive the next few years is if we can also become self-reliant, self-contained, and we can prepare ourselves and each other for the eventual situations that are going to arise. They're not going to go away. They're only going to get worse if you look at the world community. So what I say to you tonight is that if you have not signed this paper, to please sign it, to remain in contact so that, you know, I just want to jump into it like Daruba would want me to. I don't want to talk. I don't want to wave flags. I'm not interested in marching anymore. As we see what happened in Washington, D.C., it's a wonderful thing to have a whole bunch of us together and to kind of draw that energy from each other. But the fact of the matter is that we have to have something substantive in our pockets every single time we gather together. We can no longer gather to idly speak and pontificate. We have to organize and we have to build. And I hope that tonight is one of those nights when we do that. Because what I would like to see with all of the people here, that we can form a cell, we can form a survival cell starting right now, where you have the adequate food, adequate water, adequate every single thing that you need to survive a catastrophe and an emergency, and even building in mobility. Because I can tell you that they will come. That when we speak about that particular other group that is preparing now and breaking off into cells all over the country, fortified cells of their own, that they're doing this for a reason, because there are insiders within the federal government who give them information, that they are in within the law enforcement community, within the military, and they feed this information to these individuals, and many of them were part of the law enforcement community and the military community. They have inside information about what's happening in Wall Street, what's happening globally, and they're preparing and they're planning to do what they have to do to maintain themselves when this occurs. We are the only community that is continually maintaining a dependence on a system that put us in the position that we are in the first place. And I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, that to me is madness. And it's madness. We know these are the people that did this to us, but yet and still, we're going to wait for them to protect us when the you-know-what hits the fan. So I would consider this, and again, and speaking for Daruba, because again, this brother who actually was attacked by, as you said, brother, people who should be protecting him, that anyone who is dedicated enough to think about our well-being and our state of affairs when he is in pain and broken, and not broken in spirit, but broken in body at the time. But the brother was speaking through just all kinds of injuries.
That's right.
Okay? But what is he speaking about? He's speaking about what we have to do as a community. So if this brother can do this when he is infirmed, when he is injured, when he is in pain, when his family could be in jeopardy, the brother's still looking out for us, that we need to look out for ourselves, and we need to kind of have the same kind of dedication that this brother has, and to promise not to talk about doing for self. That all of the brothers and sisters, and I'll leave you with this. I remember when Sister Sophia, when she got out, I remember, she was a beautiful sister, and I remember going to, she was up in Washington Heights, if I remember the apartment in Washington Heights, and I remember when she just got out and how kind and gentle that she was, and going up into her house, and she wanted to make us tea. She wanted to make us food. And I thought to myself, my goodness, that this sister who, you know, that she just gets out and she's taken to look after us. We need to look after ourselves in the way that this sister looked after us. We have to have that kind of love for ourselves to recognize we have a responsibility to self, to do for self, and to stop talking about it, but to be about it. And that's the way that we will honor the legacy of those who came before us, and that's the way that we're going to provide the pathway for those who need this light. Because there's a lot of diffused stuff out here. There's a lot of people out here that are taking people in the wrong direction. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I don't have to name anything. We got a lot of young people that need a direction. And you know what the most important thing that they need to see? They need to see a functioning infrastructure. So that when you know what hits the fan, we can go to us for food. When someone is hurt, that we have our medics and we have our people. When we need to heal, we can go to our healers. And when we need to protect ourselves, we can do that too. We can do everything that the infrastructure can. That's what the original Panther Party stands for. That's what I've stood for all these years. And I hope that, like today, that all of us continually stay in contact, and that anything that I can do to help facilitate this, and I know that we have the people here to make it happen, that I will do everything that I can to help us help ourselves, and let's take this and let's spread this kind of attitude across the country, and let's honor Daruba bin Wahad with action, not words, with deeds, not words, with an infrastructure, not words. And I can guarantee you that when he is healed up, that is what's going to facilitate this healing, and that is what's going to give him the energy, and that's what's going to energize us, and to move into 2016 with a fortified and strong community. Thank y'all. Peace.
You all right? I'm going to pass around four nondescript, because we were kind of scrambling in time, get well cards. And each one is named, and with a pen connected to each one. And I want y'all to sign them. Don't write a book. You know, just sign each card. One is for Imam Jamil, one is for Mumia, one is for Russell, and one is for Baba Seth. Hey, son, I'm going to let you pass it around. This is TJ's son. He's been a big help to us today. Give that young man a strong hand. The only future we have. All right? Before I bring Brother Bilal Abdul-Hakim up, just some acknowledgments are in order. I want just on the shoulders of what Brother Eitan said. I opened that libation up with Che for so many reasons. Che, that was his principal inspiration in the party. Che was the mind behind a very similar revolutionary infrastructure that the Cuban revolutionaries did when they were up in the mountains before they came down and took the whole thing. That was the inspiration for that infrastructure that became the party's community survival program. So all that this comes from some very heavy places in our history, in our struggle. I want to acknowledge Mr. Lazarus Lucas from Freedom Wednesdays, who's in the house. Lazarus, please stand up, son. I want to acknowledge Fred Wynn from the People's Organization for Progress, who's in the house. I want to remind all of everyone from that our students from Essex County are doing an important gathering on October 31st. No tricks and no treats necessarily. A Stop the Violence piece right in the heart of the hood on West End Avenue and South Orange Avenue that they need some support with. And then I will be among many who will be there. And I hope you will also. I want to introduce Madam Kimberly Newberry of Decade of the Diaspora. As soon as we get out of here, we got to do this radio show that she's the star of, that's led by her mentor, the great David Horn. And we have TJ's been on that show, you know, and we're trying to get others on that show as we try and hold. Jalissa, you were just on that show. Yeah, so, you know, we're going to deal with some things there. Brother Bilal, I was talking about you right before you came in, so I ain't got to do too much to introduce you. But Bilal, in response to this ridiculous incident, took charge of the post of putting together a petition of condemnation that has now become an international point of action after this silly affair. But more than that, Bilal is somebody who was a cub of Daruba Bin Wahad. So just like you heard from Eitan and you're going to hear from TJ, and I'll have more to say later, myself and Tyari will be up in a minute. You know, we're talking about a committed life that we need to appreciate. I want Bilal to come up and not just talk about the condemnation, but this man who we love and this tradition that he represents, all right? From all the way from Paterson, New Jersey, Power Coalition, Bilal Abdul Hakim. Y'all give him a strong black hand.
I didn't know I would be coming on so early. But first of all, I want to just say, you know, it's wonderful to be here. And today was one of the days that was planned, the 49th commemoration of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense in Atlanta. This was the time they were going to be commemorating in Atlanta. However, it was changed, and we had some plans to really travel and be down there in that environment. So I want to just really thank Zay Muhammad for ever being vigilant and seizing the moment and doing something here. And in these here gatherings, when you look around, you see the numbers that we have present, chairs yet to be filled. Never be discouraged. Never be discouraged. And you know, one of the things I wrote about today was that 49 years ago, the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense that was organized by Bobby Seale and Huey P. Newton, they captured the imagination of the nation. And it wasn't a whole lot of people. You know, when people think about the Black Panther Party, they think about millions of panthers, but it wasn't millions of panthers. It was the idea that that the panthers had espoused that attracted the people, you know, to the message. So this small gathering is always significant because it starts with a very small element, and the masses of people never really respond. You know, the small element has to become the symbol of inspiration. So I just wanted to open up, with that. I had my sister stop a minute because my stomach was turning coming here, you know, and I was really trying to get up to the steak and take truck to get a welder, to call an order in before I got here, but the number was in this phone. So we had to wing it somewhere else. So I'm not gonna be, very long here, but I did want to, make that a point. The Black Panther Party is very significant in our history, brothers and sisters. I mean, I just want you to just think about it just a minute. Just think about this here a minute. When we think about the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, what comes to our mind? What comes to our mind is young men and women, black berets on, and all black with shotguns, guns, right? Is that the symbolism and image that comes to the mind, right? Well, they fed this here. This is the image that they fed to us. They fed this image as though that was the only program that the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense offered. They offered, more than that. You know, Eitan touched on it in terms of infrastructure, the basic necessities, recognizing that in the black community was an internal colony, and we still are an internal colony. We depend on everything from outside. There's nothing that we control when it comes down to the very drinking water or the water that we even bathe with. We have nothing, no say-so over how it's coming through or anything, you know? So they understood that, and they took advantage of and recognized that when the people are in that predicament, and we've heard the old saying, a nation within a nation, then you are thrust to begin to develop those necessary infrastructures to maintain your dignity and your sanity and survival. So the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense was very, very significant. And when they say it captured the imagination, you know, just regular people. I mean, it was just on the tongues of regular people. You know, I put a picture up the day of, and some of the people that are on the Facebook page probably seen the picture. I put a picture of a panther, the cat, and a picture of two elderly women with shopping bags full of groceries. You know what I mean? Because, you know, there was about it, you know, there was, you know, programs. And that phrase, I can't emphasize it enough, and I was talking about this here when we were traveling with D down in the area. There was a lot that we looked at while we were down there, and there was an article I remember reading. I forget the author, but I was up early in the morning, every morning, me and him, before everybody, so we was dialoguing like early, like about 5 o'clock in the morning, and reading different things, and the article emphasized that the very common people, you know, although they did not say that they were members of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, they admired and supported that work, and that's what made them dangerous in this society. The mere fact that they were able to impregnate the people with the idea that we could do these here things, and they were doing it. So, as you know, executive order was definitely, made to destroy the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. Speaking on Daruba, you know, and the fact that we're focusing on that particular person from the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense and out of New York chapter and former political prisoner. You know, I learned of Daruba when he was still behind the walls, when he was still being held in prison. You know, I learned about him. I took up a case of one brother, Jihad Abdul-Mumit, out of Plainfield, who was a comrade of Assata Shakur. And you know, I took his case up and began to you know, understand exactly what a political prisoner really was, because at that time, you know, a political prisoner was Nelson Mandela. Because what we had been taught was that you know, everybody that's locked up, you know, committed a crime. You know, it's criminals. So, you know, what political prisoners did we have? But as I begin to, you know, now it didn't sit well, you know, because, you know, it never sat well with me. But when I met Jihad, and I actually met Jihad, matter of fact, I got to go through the story with Jihad to get to Daruba. So I got to tell you this story. I used to do radio on WPAT. And at the time, this was at the age of beepers. Y'all remember the beepers? No cell phones. So, you know, I was working third shift, you know, doing some security, and I listened to a radio program. I had not yet started, you know, being a part of a radio program. I was just listening to it and enjoying it in the morning. And there was a book that Jihad had written, a chapter called "The Building the Infrastructure," and he would talk, and he dedicated the whole chapter to black youth. So when, as I was reading it, I said, "Damn!" I said, "He's thinking, hell, this is the way I think. I need to find him." So I traveled to go find him. When I traveled to go find him, I was told that the U.S. Marshal, that he was in Virginia. Yeah, he was in Virginia. So I traveled to Virginia, to Richmond, Virginia. When I got to Richmond, Virginia, I found out that United States Marshals had came to his house one day and just, you know, revoked his parole. You've never heard of that, right? Just revoked his parole. And because they wanted him to have our sister Asada Shakur come to a neutral place so that they could capture her or kill her, and he refused. So I never got a chance to meet Jihad. So that night when I was at work, I heard a brother in North Carolina named Khalid Griggs discussing Jihad's case. And as he began to discuss Jihad's case, I got in my car and I drove all the way home from the work site, no cell phone, and got on my phone and called and told him who I was. I wanted to get in touch with the brother, and you know, we subsequently, you know, me and him, we began writing, you know, setting up radio interviews on WBAI. At this time, you can call from the prisons and you can set your phone up and it can pipe right in, had like the three-way and all that. So we did all that right there, and he would be speaking from prison live to everyone out here. So we did all this. Now, mind you, I had never seen him in person. We had never met. The first time me and Jihad actually met was at the Metropolitan Correctional Center. They brought him back for a hearing, and there was an attorney, and you know, I love all of them, Sophia, Elijah, Jill Elijah. Yeah, you know, she was working on the case, but you know, I was much younger than I was. You know, younger people, you know, you want it done right now. Look, I don't want, and I just thought she was like dragging her feet with it. So I put some, you know, I put some things together, and I got in touch with Safia Bukhari. I met Safia Bukhari. And Safia Bukhari, you know, she started snapping the whip, you know what I mean? although they never reversed Jihad's case, more attention began to come to Jihad's case, and I became a little bit more familiar with some of the other political prisoners, like Bashir Hamid, who has since passed away. You know, I became very close with him because I wrote him a lot. And even went up to Dana Mora to go visit him. Abdullah Majid, who's going up before the parole board. You know, I remember going to visit him when they brought him down to court in Queens. And I tell you, you know, you got to be ready for this here work. And you got to be ready for the backlash and repercussion, because when I went to visit Abdullah Majid, before he went to court, they allowed me to come in. They had us in a room, and I kid you not, you remember the old telephone booths? The room was about that small, but a glass partition was separating us. So we talked, and you know, and I left. I went home, and when I got home, maybe a couple days after that, you know, the police came knocking at my door. You know, they want to know, you know, what is my relationship, you know, and things of this nature. And I told them, you know, they're part of my history, and I'm trying to find out about the story of my people, and left it like that. But you know, strange things begin to happen more and more. I ran across Daruba's case in an article, and at this time it was the City Sun. Y'all remember the City Sun?
Yes.
You know, it was the sister paper with the Amsterdam News. And all the letters I was getting from Jihad, I was learning a whole lot. But that it was this interview in the City Sun that I still have right now. I've enshrined that particular article. That particular article I read with Daruba, where they interviewed him. I said, man, I gotta find this hit man right here.
New York's Mandela.
Yeah. Exactly, that was the name. I said, I gotta find this hit man right here, because the things, Jihad was making some things clear, but Daruba, you know, like on a hot day when you need a nice, good, cool drink to quench your thirst. I mean, the way he was like dropping this thing in the article, you know what I mean? I said, wow. So I had to find this, brother. So I begin to search out, begin to read more about his case, and got involved. That's been, we going into maybe our 26th year now since TJ. We're 25 years, but we're going into the 26th year. It's been that long. In fact, we he had just introduced Mandela, right, in Harlem, right, to over 500,000 people. People in the United States didn't know that, because when Daruba was introducing Nelson Mandela, the stations went to a commercial. Yeah, they went to a commercial, and the only thing that people remember when Mandela was here in America making his round, I'm a Yankee, when he was at Yankee Stadium. But they didn't see how Daruba had electrified that half a million people. I subsequently got in touch with Daruba and got him to come to Patterson, to Passaic County Community College. It was the first political prisoner forum ever held in that town. And I'm laughing right now, because when I say you have to be prepared, now we had already booked there, gave us a place, we had people in place, the Organization of African Ancestry, to make sure that we didn't have to pay no extra fees, so we have the auditorium. We booked it, we ready to roll. And the very same day, guess what they booked? Right next door to us, inside the gymnasium. A rap concert with Eric B. and Rakim at the same time. This wasn't even on the... So when he got there, I told him, look, this is what's happening. So you know what we did? We left from where we were at. Remember Eitan? We went over where Eric B. and Rakim is at. In fact, I still have this here footage, and I got to get it so that we can actually put it in one of these here documentaries. And we talked with them, went over there, talked with him down in the library, Eric B. and Rakim, went back inside, had some words, and then we went back over there, and that was our beginning. So we begin to, like I said, we travel, all over the country, and I'm gonna get to where I'm going at, but I'm just mentioning these here things that we went through. I traveled to D.C., and we had a whole crew with us, Malik, Kwame. It was a crew that traveled with us when we traveled throughout the country. And I'll never forget this here one time when we traveled to Washington, D.C. We went to a hemp conference. It was at a hemp conference. You know, when people think about marijuana, they just, is one-dimensional. But, the hemp plant has been used for thousands of years for many different things. So this, we learned these here things as well, while we were there, in Daruba, and his, matter of fact, TJ was there too. Yeah. In DC. We were at the Capitol. If any of you seen the documentary, Passing It On, you'll see when Daruba is talking. I think Kimmy is on one side, TJ, Kwame, and you'll see me. I'm turned this way with a trench coat on. because we had like a diamond back on security on, because our chant back then, like people was talking about, I want to be Mike. We was talking about, man, I want to be at the Ruba Ben Wahai, you know, because it was about community control, developing your community and things of that that nature. So we left after he spoke. And as we were leaving, I'll never forget this. We were walking. Daruba was on my right side. Malik was on the left of Daruba. We were walking, and as we were walking, an officer put a shotgun. I'm a young kid, you understand? Put a shotgun right the barrel, right on me, and was standing right on this side with a revolver pointed straight at my head. And I didn't flinch. I just asked him. I said, "What's all this about?" He said, "Oh, we have to protect ourselves." We said, "Protect yourself from what?" So you have all that type of intimidation, going on. But the thing that really made me and others gravitate towards Daruba so much. A lot of times, when young people get involved in work, and you interact with older people, they tend to want to dominate you, you know? Never forget watching an old Joe Frazier fight, his son, Marvis Frazier. And the father sitting back there, you know, the son getting beat down. He trying to tell the son, you know, throw this, throw that. Now, Daruba wasn't telling us that. Daruba said, look, y'all going to make your own you got to make your own mistakes. He said, you're going to make your own mistakes. He said, but my job is to equip you so that the mistakes that we made, you ain't got to make those, those same mistakes. So those lessons, we began to take those lessons real well, you know. He nurtured us very well. We began to learn very early about the messianic complex that plagues particularly black folks. You know, we plagued by that. You know, we want somebody to come and save us. And we believe that, you know. I mean, if I told all of you here right now, and forgive me, you know, if I offend anyone, because I don't intend to, you know, to be offensive. But if I told all of you right now, standing here right now, that last night I went to sleep, and when I woke up, I looked out the window. When I looked out the window, there was a spaceship right there. And some little men came out on that spaceship and told me, Bilal, you go there today and you give it to them at the Norg Library. You tell me right now, which one of y'all gonna believe that right now? Anybody volunteer, who will believe that? No, you'll say, man has the capacity to become delusional, right? So, you know, these are the type of things. You know, Eitan alluded to these. You know, we have all type of people peddling their doctrine to take people in different directions. And I'm telling you, they're taking us down a dead-end path. Wind this here down on this here. Yeah, okay, I got to wind down because they're going to be coming in a minute. The cases with Eric Gardner, the big cases, Eric Gardner and Brown, they were personal assaults. Let me know when he's there, all right? TJ, let me know. Okay. There were personal injury cases. Eric Brown and Eric Gardner and Mike Brown. However, each and every one of us was impacted and affected by it. Is that right? We were all affected by it. I mean, I went to many of the gatherings, and people were out there. They were affected by it because the people went out and gathered out there because they were expecting something. They thought something would come out of all of that right there. You thought something would come out of them too. That's why we go out and have these big demonstrations. There's a yearning in us. What happens, we don't watch how these people, they switch the bait on us. A personal injury, right? You follow me with this here. It's a personal injury. The family is grieving. But we're all affected by this right here. It becomes a class action assault on each and every one of us. That's the reason why we're all out there. Now, we're out there because we don't realize that somebody, the Pied Piper, has come along. The Pied Piper has come along and begin to play his instrument and have us running in circle, as I was telling my sister, the way the dog chases his tail. And the dog never catches his tail. So we're running, our energy is being redirected and dissipated. And what happens? It's just like, getting the thrill and then coming back down off that thrill. And then what happens? The class action that we thought we were all involved in becomes a personal injury case where we're in civil court and people are receiving a payment. This is, this is a problem. And daring to talk like this here, daring to talk like this right here, people want to fight and people want to attack you because they don't want this type of message to be heard because they want to keep people, head in the cloud. It's time for us to come out of the clouds. It's time for us to be direct and real. There are a lot of things that are happening right before our very eyes, and we do not have any more time to waste with people with the dream merchant. With the dream merchant, wishing, on a dream. So I just want to, end with that because I was just really getting warmed up to go into a whole nother gear. That's how I start sometimes. But Daruba is definitely one of the he's one of the special ones because out of the political prisoners, we spent a lot of time with him, not only traveling, but a lot of time in teaching sessions. I said, I talk with him almost every day. And somehow, sometimes I get the feeling that he talks to me so long, because he'll go a whole hour on the phone and sharing detailed information. I'm going to say this here and then be going with this here. When Daruba got released from prison, right, New York State, they awarded him money. Most people think that when you get awarded money, the person, he got the money and he just wanted the money. No. Those lawyers have sacrificed it out of their own pockets for years. So the money that New York State awarded Daruba, guess who he gave the money to? He gave look, that is some person, That is some person to be around. That man gave the money to the lawyers. And the lawyers themselves just decided that out of their share, they would give him, they gave him a piece of his share. What a human being, So, this is a very special, a person. I don't mean to make him bigger than life, but he's a genuine human being, as Eitan mentioned, and I can't emphasize it enough, being there with him. And I couldn't sleep until I got there after the assault. I couldn't sleep until I got there. I was having nightmares every night until I got there because I just felt that he was in mortal danger. And I thought that if we're going to be in mortal danger, then I want to be right there, to deal with some of the cushion of it. So, we got ourselves up down there. But to see a man physically, wounded, but spirit, still working and trying to find answers and trying to arrive at the most progressive conclusion, it's a testament to his human dignity, he's definitely one of our Mandelas. And what I used to always tell Bashir Hamid, and I'm gonna let Brother Zaid come and bring the poet on, that he used to ask me in letters all the time. He said, you know, y'all so big on Daruba, right? Now, this is one of his comrades who old enough to be our grandfathers and fathers. And I would tell him in the letters, I said, well, Daruba, out of all of the work that everyone was doing in the country around political prisoners, he came out of prison and he single-handedly electrified the entire atmosphere about the issue of political prisoners. I'm talking about so much, brothers and sisters, that in my town, and you know, I met some anarchists. That's my phone. You can see. When they were planning on killing Mumia Abu-Jamal, we had got some pictures bigger than that, twice that. And we went all over the city. We had got some special type of glue and the whole city woke up wondering, who was Mumia? There's a little bit more, but he's on the phone. But thank you for your time.
DJ Zionia? Okay. All right, let me bring my goddaughter. You got one ready. You got 100, right? I gave her permission to do an original one for tonight. That one isn't ready. They don't fall off trees like ripe fruit. They have to be nurtured, right? I just did that because I got one. See, I was ready for it, right? So listen, Makicha, give us strong hands. Spoken water, spoken word is in the house tonight.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to share one piece called Revolution, but it's revolution with a question mark. Freedom fighting ain't like it used to be. We no longer fight for rights, just for anything that's free. Like free parking, free before 12, and free giveaways. Nothing has changed but the times. We're just the new form, the modern day slave. How can we coexist with greats when our values are poor? And though we say we don't judge, church's loyalty is measured by collection plates. Black people still argue over dark skin or light. And we think it's cute that these modern day children don't know wrong from right. They can't spell their names, but they can work iPads. And the world is full of absent-minded mothers and stepdads. Dreams for adolescents to grow up playing basketball and such. What happened to the days of little girls with beads and ponytails playing double dutch? Everybody wants to put down on paper that they're part of the revolution. Until pens are dropped and it's time to suit up for execution. And parents are less excited about homework and more interested in kids twerking. And the lazy sit on their behinds while welfare's working. This generation knows nothing about picketing signs. But they'll give their dreams a chance and join picket lines. The lottery won't save your life when there's shootings every day. The innocents are targeted while the violent get away. And everybody wants to get rich, but know nothing about being wealthy. And while everyone is on this health phase, they make it so that the poor cannot afford to become healthy. Nothing is being done about poverty-stricken communities that exist within plain sight. We want our kids to dream, but hunger keeps them up at night. The young contemplate suicide because there is no outlet. They battle with homosexuality because while they want to tell the words won't come out yet. Families work 3 jobs for bill deadlines they can't meet, while veterans fight for a country that makes it hard for them to get back up on their feet. Gun laws are too lenient while weapons are still being concealed, and funeral homes are making a killing off of youth being killed. The television ain't no different, using ignorance to block your view. And while you laughing at your future's legacy, millionaires are making millions off of you. Negroes sang spirituals like We Shall Overcome when dissected is more than just a song. Gil Scott Herring said the revolution would not be televised, but TVs are still on. Revolution, thank you. Baba Zayi.
Yeah. So y'all give it to him. Now what's interesting, why I have to just love that particular moment. In this room, January 1988, a young poet named Brother Zaid Muhammad organized the first book party for Assata Shakur right here in this spot. That's what set all these gatherings in this town, in this tradition off. Now we're going to do a little call a response, because DeRuba's going to be on in a minute. Now, I had gave her a mission to come up with a new one that she's still working on, because I already had one ready for her, all right? Now, for those of you who are my age and up, and some of y'all are down, you know that the last poets, one of the greatest poets of all time was Niggas is Scared of Revolution. So here's a creative response at this particular moment to that as we wait for DeRuba to come through. And this is done. He's on? Oh, forget it. Time out. Time out. Time out. Let's get him on.
Dave? Dave? Yes, go ahead. Keep talking. D?
Yeah.
All right.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we're trying to adjust the sound now.
There's no time to be modest. Go ahead and talk to us, black man.
How you doing, man?
You know SB.
How's it going?
Sorry, folks are waiting to hear from you. Got the young eyes, old eyes, and older eyes. The loud just got finished dropping. Are you still there? We still got you?
Yeah.
All right, we got technical difficulties. Those of my age don't know what that means.
The Bluetooth device is ready to pair. Connect you successfully.
Okay. Yeah.
Everything okay now?
Yeah. Better. Mic is yours.
Oh, the mic is back?
Yeah, sure. We got it. So listen, we got a small crowd, about 30 people here. We just had some dynamite poetry. Brother Aton blessed us. Brother Bilal came and spoke to us, but of course, we promised the people that we're going to be able to hear directly from you. And so the floor is yours. And then we got about 20 minutes, so you can take as much time as you need. And then if you stop short, we can get some questions going.
Okay. Well, first of all, I want to thank everyone that came out this evening to commemorate the legacy. Sense of party and the comrades who sacrificed not only their lives, but many of them their livelihood. And it's just appreciative. I'm appreciative of the fact that Brother Zaid and TJ and other folks there were able to pull this together under these trying circumstances. One of the things I wanted to mention to folks is that after the so-called Million Man March, there has been a heightened expectation from ordinary black folks and activists in regards to where we're going now as communities, as people. And I think that, that heightened awareness, that heightened consciousness, the need for all of us to want to contribute to something positive, to save our children from a future of miseducation and imprisonment and terrorism at the hands of the state, that heightened expectation right now requires that we begin to organize ourselves, that we should begin to put together those types of projects, programs, and organizations that will empower us, that will empower us on a local level, that will make us independent of the status quo of the institutions that control our lives right now. And although this may seem like a daunting task, it's not. The United States, in terms of its overall economic power, its military power abroad, its use of its resources, the misuse of its resources on its own people, has created the type of historical moment where our voices count. Our ability to organize, even if it's just in our own building, can change can change lives and make a difference. So I'm very honored that folks came together and even put my name on the program to commemorate the legacy of the BPT and all of those brothers and sisters who went before, that laid the groundwork before, over the decades, over the years. And I want to say that legacy continues. We have a number of brothers in prison. We have people in exile that need to come home. So there's a lot of work to be done, and that legacy is only something that we should attach to in order to inform our work now. So, I mean, that's basically what I have to say. I guess if we could open up the floor to those people there who might want to ask some questions, who might want to say something in this regard.
Peace and blessing, brother. What's your message to the youth who are galvanizing in the streets like Baltimore, Cincinnati, and those other cities that are having the uprisings and the mass police brutality issues that are going on in the country?
Well, first of all, we need to understand that right now we wouldn't be having the dialogue and the social awareness of police militarization and repression and the issues of race discussed in the public arenas were it not for the young brothers and sisters who stayed on the streets despite all of those Negroes who tried to get them to desist. I think that young people need to stay on in the forefront of the struggle. I think we need to stay on the street. We need to heighten the contradictions between our community and those institutions that oppress us. So I just want to say that I have an immense amount of respect for the young soldiers and young activists who have stayed on the streets and demanded justice for the families and the victims of police murder and police brutality, and that we need to build from that. And I think that what we need to build is a new abolitionist movement. We need to understand that reform won't change our condition, that reforming the prison systems and the criminal justice system won't change how that system deals with us and how it maintains us in the type of oppression and terrorism that it presently does. So I think that we need to begin to understand that what these young folks are really signifying with their stand against the state, against the police state, is that we need a new abolitionist movement. We need a movement that will talk about abolishing policing as we now know it and reconstituting it on a community level and on a public level where the taxpayers, people, control these institutions and determine their policies. So I just want to urge young people to stay in their faith, stay in the face of the enemy, to stay in the face of the state, and that we need to understand that our ability to disrupt the status quo is one of the most potent weapons that we have today in determining the dialogue around race and white supremacy.
Excellent. Anybody else? Brother Rad?
Peace. My name is Brother Rad Ford. I'm with the Student Entertainment Organization. I'd like to ask you a question about, it's an issue with black-on-black crimes that's perpetuating this conspiracy to destroy our people. It's organizations, street gangs, and drug dealers in our community that's like implementing this conspiracy. What would you say to them in order to help motivate them to change that their philosophies?
Well, first of all, you know, the terminology "black on black crime" is a reaction, a contrived reaction in many ways by the state in order to deflect our youth and our communities from the real enemy, the real criminals that run this society, the 1% that control the economics of this country. the real criminals that run this society are the ones who are in positions of power and control right now and who carry out white supremacy on a daily basis institutionally. Now, that's not to say that black people, because of our proximity to each other, because we live in basically domestic colonies, in communities that are overcrowded, that are poor, that have poor housing, that in many ways we carry out negative attitudes and negative behavior towards each other. I mean, the United States has been at war in Afghanistan for the past 15 years. It has been at war for 85% of its national existence, the time of its national existence. And no one calls the United States a violent society. When World War II erupted, no one called it white-on-white crime. Violence as such is the negative behavioral pattern of human beings. So we need to understand that in Palestine, as we speak right now, the youth are in the streets throwing rocks at the Zionist settlers, at the occupying forces. Our children have no example of resistance against the status quo and against the police, as the Palestinians do. So therefore, our youth have internalized their violence. We have internalized white supremacy. We have internalized it to the point where we have a high degree of self-hatred, of disrespect for each other. And I think that we need to understand the role that these street sets that we call gangs play in the upbringing of young males and young females in this society. They are a rite of passage. They have always been a rite of passage in the urban areas. That's what urban gangs have been. There were Irish gangs. There were Italian gangs. There were Polish gangs. Most minorities in urban areas had to resort to coming together and forging these types of street sets and relationships in order to defend themselves, in order to protect themselves from aggression from outside of their community. This has been turned on its head in our community because there's no struggle on the physical level against our oppressors. And we need to make it clear to our youth that we need them to be the soldiers in the forefront of our struggle for independence, for survival, and for the integrity of our community. Our youth are misled. They're misled by a system of propaganda, of misinformation. They're misled by educational systems that teaches them what to think and not how to think. We are misled by a culture that has devalued the family, that has devalued the role of parents in society, and that have assumed that role institutionally in order to control our own children. So we need to reinvigorate our ability to talk to our children and get them to stand up for something other than a new pair of sneakers or a slick outfit, a slick shirt. They need to understand that our children right now have to take the forefront, have to be in the vanguard of our struggle against white supremacy and against the domination in our community. And this is a physical struggle, this is a political struggle, this is a psychological struggle, and this is a social and cultural struggle. All of these different aspects of our oppression have to be addressed. And the police in our community who are brutalizing our youth, who are murdering our youth, need to understand that they cannot do that with impunity. That if they kill our dog, we'll murder their cat. And so we need to understand, they have to understand, that there will be a political retaliation, there will be a political consequence for police brutality in our community. And the ones that bring that message to law enforcement and to those who brutalize us are our youth. And so we need to organize our youth in a way that they can protect the community, that they can see that they are part and parcel of us, that they're not alienated from us, that we have not thrown them to the wolves in blue uniforms, and we have not forsaken them to a system of mass incarceration. And once we could exhibit that type of care and that type of love, I think our children, our youth, will begin to fight on a much more principled level. And I just want to end with this, that, there's a lot to be said about guns in America, about the use of arms in America, about how guns kill people. Well, people with guns kill people. Guns themselves are instruments of violence. They're instruments of force. And we need to understand that when you have a gun and no politics and no consciousness, you're a criminal. You're an anarchist. You're someone who is a liability to all those around you. But when you have consciousness, and when you have principles, and when you have ethics and morality, then you can change that paradigm of that we talk about, that we define as black on black crime, and make it into a revolutionary understanding of how violence is, has a purpose, and is in all of us. All of us are human beings. We all have the normal capacities and emotions for violence. It's just that it's been socialized negatively in our community. The whole idea of black self-defense is about using violence to defend our own integrity, to defend our children, to defend our communities, and to defend our families. So all animals, all mammals, all living things have a capacity for violence. And it's usually used for survival. In our case, it's self-destructive. It's being used negatively and in a self-destructive fashion. And we have not trained our children to understand the limits of violence and its utility at the same time.
Hey, Daruba. Hey, Daruba. Obama's a lame duck. The economy's kind of shaky. Folks are talking about Hill or Bear, or white folks are talking about Trump. What are we going to do in 2016? What are you going to tell us to do?
Like I said, we need to build new abolitionist movements. We need to understand that reform will not change our condition. So we need an independent political party that expresses this notion. We need to recruit everyone from grandmothers to preachers, from imams to the thug on the corner. We need to build a political presence that challenges the duopoly of the Democratic and Republican parties. And until we have our own independent political formation, until we could organize political clubs in our community to maximize our voices locally and across the state, we will still be victimized by the comprador class, by these Negroes running for office who have more fidelity to the status quo, to white supremacy, than they have to us. So we have to challenge these individuals, and we have to understand that even in this society today, we are not using our political power the way we should. It's being diffused. It's being weakened by our own political class, by those opportunists and those middle class individuals who identify with the system, who identify with the institutions that oppress us. So we need an independent political party that's rooted in the radical tradition of black nationalism, as Malcolm expressed it, that's rooted in the needs of our community, and that stands up for us in the political arena. Right now, the political parties, the Democrats and the Republicans, are two faces of the same coin. So we cannot expect any type of salvation from them. We have to have our own political party. We have the abolitionist movement to support that type of effort. And we have to mobilize those individuals who are incarcerated, who were incarcerated, who have criminal records, and begin to employ them and use them in our community in this matter. It's said that fully 5% of the voting power of African communities, inner city African communities, are lost to the mass incarceration, are lost to felony conviction, that many of our brothers and sisters who have been in prison don't vote. They don't have the ability to vote, and they don't have anyone to vote for if they could vote. So we need to change that paradigm.
Hey, bro, listen. We got a few minutes left, but just to kind of bring it full circle, you know, the Panthers and the survival programs that y'all instituted along with the self-defense. Brother Eitan just talked a little bit earlier about the infrastructure that we need. So can you kind of bridge that gap between
the survival programs back in the day and what you think we need today in terms of infrastructure for survival moving forward.
Well, you know, the Black Panther Party had a 10-point program, and when you look at the 10-point program, you would see that it was nothing very revolutionary about it. It was a very basic program, what we want and what we need. And so we know that we need to have control over our communities. We know we need to have decentralization of police and public safety. We know that we have to be able to build independent infrastructures, whether we're talking about taking advantage of owning property in our community, seizing property in our community from absentee landlords, developing that property by employing our youth and training them in rehabilitating housing in our community, using solar energy to build to get off the grid. We have to understand that we are subjected to the mercy of institutions and mass corp and corporations that control our everyday life. And until we begin to break those types of control, we're not going to be able to talk about anything that resembles respect for Black lives and for our people and for our children. So we really need to build have projects that increase our ability to get off of the grid, to take care of our own. We have to ask ourselves, what are we going to do if the lights go out tomorrow and don't come back on? What will happen if we turn on our water faucet and no water comes out? What are we going to do? And then when we understand how these infrastructures function, when we understand that the people who service these infrastructures live in our community, they're our grandchildren, they're our children, they're the person that work at Con Edison, they work at AT&T, they work in subway systems. They have the expertise in running these systems, and we need to tap into that expertise and to begin to build alternative systems of supply, of dealing with our needs on a local and on a state level. And this can be done. And so we really have to look at that. We really have to look at how we can go into the churches and go into the masjid and get the clergy to begin to build the type of community infrastructures that can service the needs of our elders, that can deal with families in case of a natural or man-made catastrophe. I'm quite sure Eitan addressed a lot of that earlier this evening.
Right.
We have to understand a lot of that is dual. A lot of the training that we need as volunteer first responders, a lot of that training is available to us, and most of it is available to us free of charge. Let's understand too that FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management and Assistance Program Administration, it has been trying to organize and train local people and make them responsible to FEMA and to the federal government. We need to use that type of model and make responsibility and direct the responsibility to us and to our communities and to the elders in our communities. So we need to really get to work on building independent community enclaves. We need to run the police out of our community by decentralization, using the ballot and the electoral process to decentralize the police. We need to challenge the political clout of police unions who are right now, as we speak, lobbying for more repressive and racist legislation on the state level and on the national level. So we have a lot of work to do in terms of empowering ourselves and our children. And I just want to end by saying, you know, I'm sitting in a park right now in Georgia, where there are literally hundreds of kids involved in a football program. There are dozens and dozens of families here who have their children involved in the positive athletics here, and here it's like another family. We could replicate the same type of attitude with our youth in our streets, in our communities, in our churches, and in our mosques. We have to understand that we are the controllers of our own destiny, not our enemy. We need to take control of our own destiny.
Awesome. Thanks, Dee. We love you. All power to the people. And he's doing that with his jaw being wired in three places. You want to tell your story?
Let me get this. Let me give y'all this. Because I told her I would. All right?
This is the first time I'm showing my age, daughter. This is the first time I'm reading a poem.
Off the phone.
I need some paper. Right?
No.
It's called Real Niggas. Child is born with a heart of gold. Way of the world turns his heart stone cold. Where are niggas when the revolution needs some shots? Niggas are scared of revolution. Give me some real niggas. I mean some ride or die for the people niggas. In this time, on this earth, on this space, on this place, I want me some we won't die, we multiply niggas. Not no spineless niggas, not no commercial fake niggas, not no mindless chewing on darkness niggas, and certainly no buck dancing soul selling niggas. I mean some real niggas. Neck slicing, land snatching niggas like Bookman, Toussaint, and Dessalines. Underground Railroad raw niggas, cutthroat commando niggas like Harriet Tubman, like Nat Turner fertilizing Virginia plantations with white blood on top of black blood. Some machete master monster niggas like Carletta of Cuba, Malcolm Bold, Khalid Cole. I want me some real niggas. Niggas who will put it all on the line, like all them niggas who walked off them plantations into the Union Army and won the Civil War and our freedom with their own hands. In this time, when our kids are planning their own funerals instead of planning their futures. In these maddening, dangerous, dark times, I want some niggas who will run to the light and fight. Revolutionary red niggas like Che, Fidel, and Babu. Black and proud niggas like Garvey and Lumumba. Green return to the source niggas like Cabral and Sankara. Proper niggas need not apply unless they're grounded in proper people's politics like Du Bois, like Nkrumah, like Ho Chi Minh, like Walter Rodney. I mean some real niggas. Malcolm Bowe, Khalid Cole, real niggas. Niggas who when prayer don't work, when singing don't work, when marching don't work, when legislating don't work, when praying, singing, marching, and legislating all put together don't work. Niggas who will do unto those as they do unto us. I mean some shoot back niggas. I mean niggas, bloods, if you must be bloods like them clan killing bloods known as the African Blood Brotherhood bloods. Blood, blood, reciprocal real niggas who will shoot back like Lolita and company shot back, like the Deacons of Defense shot back, like Robert Williams and those niggas with guns shot back, like Lowndes County and Greene County niggas behind Kwame and Rep shot back, making the ballot of the bullet a real. Like Huey and Bobby and Geronimo letting pigs know that they would shoot back. Like Amiri showed Adonisio and Imperiali that they would shoot back. Like the Legionnaires holding the red, black, and green high shot back in that March midnight sky. Like them Plainfield niggas who cleaned out that rifle factory in 68 shot back. Like how the BLA shot back. Malcolm Bowe, Khalid Cole, niggas who won't be red, white, and blue. Butterfly bad, refuse to lose niggas like Muhammad Ali. Young and restless niggas like them marching niggas, Lord and Orwell Barrio. Machetero versus backward macho niggas, blowing up on these bastards like Guillermo. Niggas like them boys in the hood from St. Petersburg who shot back in 86 and 96 and had pigs scurrying like burnt rats. In this time, in this place, I want me some real niggas. Niggas who are man enough, strong enough, smart enough, bad enough to work, to build, to make children, to make good for our children, to love their mothers making them. Men strong enough, smart enough, bad enough, real enough to let nothing or no one come in between that. I want me some real niggas.
Niggas who are real clear. Niggas who will store the prize in our baby's eyes, exorcising them from violent, self-destructive lies. Niggas who will do that by any means necessary. Malcolm Bowe, Khaled Cole, some ride or die for the people niggas. Real niggas, real niggas, real niggas like that. That's the way of the world. Plant your flower and you grow a pearl. Child is born with a heart of gold. Way of the world turns his heart stone cold. Real niggas, real niggas.
Over these pictures real quick, because I know some of y'all are trying to figure out what's what, especially for our younger heads in here. Huh? Just a quick
yeah, little give me
line of history that we've been
giving us the
huh?
Yeah. Out there giving us the
oh, okay, all right. Y'all see this? This is Daruba. On his, on my right, on my left is Jamal Joseph. He was called the Panther Baby. He's got a film out called, what's the film called?
Which one?
New one, Jamal. Chapter and Verse.
Yeah, okay.
Chapter and Verse, we're gonna try and do a special showing of that. And to my right is Afeni Shakur, right? Afeni, this is Pac's mother, right? Pac was literally born while his mother was on trial for his life. Our most famous Panther Cub, right? You got that, Rob? Right? Okay, it's some history. Y'all heard Bilal talking about some situations he had with D. This is, we brought him out of court. State of New York was trying to put him back in prison after he got out. This is one of the covers from what became the film Passing It On. That's Bilal and I when we were much younger. 1994. The last two, now, of course you know Solid, right? But the picture, the bigger picture, that's Daruba introducing Nelson Mandela as a consequence of what a long way grab in the hell we raised to try to make that happen. That's thank you, Freddie, right? And right next to that, this is the most recent picture. That's Daruba in the baseball hat. Next to his lawyer, Bob Boyle. And next to Bob is Marshall Eddie Conway, who was just released in this picture after 44 years of being inside. Marshall Eddie Cunningham. Okay? So this is the legacy. This is Smitty. Y'all been talking about Smitty the Libation. The greatest.
Smitty.
Okay? So these are some lessons. You know, there's some lessons. All right, we're gonna wind up. We appreciate everybody coming out. Hope everybody got everybody's information. Hope you signed the cards for the Freedom Fighters. We're gonna get them out. We'll be in touch with some things that we're trying to do. You want to get on board and be a part of this? Please let us know. We're going to take this somewhere else. All right? All right. We'll see you in the whirlwind on Power to the Beat.
Power to the Beat.